is a story about America, right? What it means to be a man.
These are very interesting and very timely pieces.
We just want to keep the memory alive so the history of the telephone isn't lost.
Today on Spotlight, learn how to create your very own video game with help from local inventors. Plus, a memoir tackling football culture with a compelling story about a boy named Zach. And then, the unique museum dedicated to telephones. But first, a special spot you might not know about inside the Fabulous Fox. It's Sunday, and you're watching Spotlight.
Have you ever come into the lobby at the Fabulous Fox Theater and notice those mysterious windows near the top? Okay, probably not. It's a long way up there. But once you see what's up there, you might just want to make the climb.
Well, here we are in Peacock Alley.
You won't find this alley on Google Maps. Most visitors to the Fox don't even know it's here. But up on the fourth floor, in the hallway between the left and right side of the house, is a look at all the shows that have called this place home.
And here we are up to 2002 with Mamma Mia and the Producers. Oh, that was one of my favorite shows. Here's Guys and Dolls, another wonderful show that was in here.
Peacock Alley is a year-by-year series of collages featuring every show that has played at the Fox since it reopened in 1982. The first show was Barnum.
When the Fox opened, back in January of 1929, Peacock Alley was an art gallery. It was very plain when the Fox reopened, and it remained like that until they made Peacock Alley out of it.
The name is a reference to the decorative peacocks you'll find at either end of the hall.
And here we have the Righteous Brothers. We have Music of the Night.
To see the names of every show that is played here, you have to read the fine print.
If you want to dig into it, yes. But there's enough pictorial there to remind you of a lot of good times without going through that.
The shows that have played the Fabulous Fox cover a wide range. Really, just about anything goes. There was Sunset Boulevard, 42nd Street, and Avenue Q. Sinatra impersonators and Sinatra in person. Dolly and Hello, Dolly.
And there's David Copperfield.
They've had The Wizard of Oz, The Wiz, and The Miz. Barry Manilow's Copacabana, and Barry Manilow.
There's a little something here for everybody.
There was Leno and Lena, Showboat and Titanic, Blast and Stomp.
Oh, that was a lively show. They have a few more years to go before they run out of wall space there. They've gone around the corner and gone into the elevator lobby.
And that is also where you'll find a special tribute to the theater's late great organist, Stan Kahn. There's even one of his old vacuum cleaners on display. If you don't know why, Google it. So the next time you come to see a show at the Fox, come see the show before the show. You'll probably be reminded of a few you forgot you saw. Think of it as a trip down memory alley.
Oh, I think this is great. You know, it's a little history lesson for all of those, both young and old. It's just really a neat place to be.
Follow HEC Media on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
The early years of pixel art and video games ignited the imaginations of children, including these boys, now men.
Video games were becoming more prolific in the home, so it was transitioning from the arcade into the home through systems like Atari and Nintendo. And in addition to playing these games, I started to get the idea of wanting to make those games.
They are co-founders of Pixel Press, a St. Louis company that created an all-new video game experience for children. Rob Bennett is another co-founder and CEO.
We created the arcade in order for kids and people of all ages to be able to build video games and share them.
It's all done with their video game creation platform, Bloxels Builder. that takes game creation to a new level. It allows children to build their own characters, game features, and gaming experience.
It takes colored blocks, 8 different colors, and each of those blocks has a meaning. Once they've assembled them on the game board, they're actually using the camera on their tablet or their phone to take a picture of what they've built. And our technology recognizes the colors using optical character recognition to recognize what those shapes and colors are, and ultimately turns that into data that's imported into our video game creation engine.
Just want to show you guys the packaging and do a quick demo for you. So Josh,
Toy Fair New York 2015 was a huge success for the Pixel Press team. They made Bloxels known to the world as it ranked among the fair's best. Soon after, Bloxels hit store shelves of major retailers. Then the company launched Bloxels EDU. Bloxels EDU is now used in about 25,000 classrooms in the U.S., approaching 45,000 classrooms globally.
Whatever story you want to tell, you can tell. And when you get in a room full of kids today, a week from now, a month from now, every kid has a different story to tell.
So we wanted to give them a spatial, or sometimes called kinesthetic, way to create this content and ultimately bring it to life.
The ugly sweater puppy came to life. He's blinking his eyes and wagging his tail. My character is going to be a rainbow, and then the enemy is going to be a raindrop.
He's like a little robot dude. You have to go through 5 enemies. You can collect all the coins, and you have to do a tricky jump to get around.
This group made a game about the life cycle of a butterfly.
So the eggs are going to hatch, and then they're going to go through the level, and when they beat the level, they're going to turn out to be a butterfly.
Bloxels EDU is actually all-encompassing of the tools for the students and then also a component for the teachers, so they could pull down a lesson about ancient Egypt or maybe about space or maybe about the journey of the cell.
Also the software platform, so how do they manage student accounts and also to actually grade the process.
We love the one-to-one relationship that we have with those educators. We can talk to them, we get feedback from them.
With the pandemic, there were problems getting game boards into the hands of students who are not in the classroom for distance learning. This created a company shift. In addition to the physical board and blocks, Bloxels is now digital.
You don't have the board and blocks, or you're not using the board and blocks, say for distance learning reasons. You can actually use the app itself. So if you open the app, go into the game builder or the character builder, there'll be a digital representation of that board, and you can select a color and then draw with that color, select a different color, draw with that color. And that has all of the EDU features as well as all of the personal edition features. It just depends on how you log in.
Another pandemic pivot is focused on engaging all users, individual gamers, and classrooms through their virtual video series.
It's called Featured Friday. So basically, we created the arcade. We started seeing some really, really awesome stuff, and we decided to start a Featured Friday YouTube series. We'll do themed episodes, usually around something that's kind of going on at the moment, whether it's a holiday or it's something that's going on in the world. Sometimes we'll be a little bit more abstract and we'll talk about great games based around biology and geometry.
You'll see it actually incorporates information about Anne Frank.
That was a super cool game. You should definitely check it out.
It's a great way to show what they've learned through creating a video game and telling the story of the information that they've just taken in.
Oh, this is the start.
Los Angeles Raiders and the New Orleans Saints on ABC Monday Night Football.
From the NFL to youth leagues, the crashing of helmets and the roaring crowds, the culture of football is as ingrained in our American culture as mom and apple pie. And the harder players hit, the louder the cheers. With each hit and tackle is the chance any player can develop CTE, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, a progressive brain disease caused by repetitive hits to the head with symptoms like dementia, slurred speech, severe headaches, depression, anxiety, and problems with balance and vision that don't appear until years after the injuries. Sadly, the only way to determine if a patient has CTE is to examine their brain after they're dead. Zach Easter of Indianola, Iowa, was tormented by all the symptoms and took his own life at the age of 24.
Story about a guy who fully bought into that that football culture and sort of that tough it out culture, which eventually became Zach Easter's demise.
In his book, Love Zach, Small Town Football and the Life and Death of an American Boy, Forgrave explores the mindset of the sport and Zach's football-obsessed community.
I mean, this was how Zach defined what it meant to be a man. He was the middle son of three sons. His family had lived on this land in outside of small town Iowa for seven generations since before the Civil War. And their definition of what it meant to be a man very much sprung from living off the land and hunting and being tough. And in modern day America, often the way that that is expressed is through football. So is it a cautionary tale? Yes, absolutely. Especially for someone like myself, who's a parent of two young boys. I don't think this book says, don't play football. Football should go away. Not in any means. It goes into both the risks of football and the rewards of football. This is a story about Zach, but really I think this is a story about America, right? Like what it means to be a man in 21st century America.
I realize that some of this might be shocking for some of you reading this, but anything I've portrayed to anyone in the past 6 years has been a lie to conceal.
It was Zach's handwritten journals that intrigued Minneapolis sports writer Reid Forgrave to learn more about Zach's struggles after being diagnosed with five concussions, three while playing high school football.
I don't look back on my life with regrets because at the time I loved my social identity of being the tough guy and being popular because of football.
He titled it Concussions, My Silent Struggle. And it documents how going back to third grade when he started playing tackle football up through high school, when he stopped, concussions happened again and again and again, and he really suffered through them.
I know for a fact that all the things I've experienced in my life are from using my head as a weapon.
How do you explain Zach's moments when he was lucid enough to be so descriptive about what he wanted done, how he felt, versus someone else who takes their own life and leaves nothing?
Yeah, I mean, he had some sort of foresight that he should write this down. He pings back and forth between being hopeful and being like, I'm going to go get this job. I'm going to apply for six jobs today. I'm going to quit chewing tobacco in the next month. I'm going to be a millionaire in 5 years. You see him have these big ambitions. And then 2 days later, you see him say, I went to the therapist today, but I just sat in my car in the parking lot. I couldn't go in. That's very CTE of him. I like to think that Zach, in a way, knew that there was some sort of value somehow, for himself and his own memory issues, but also just for writing this down in a way for history. And it was, I mean, without Zach's writings, this isn't a book. It's a tragedy. But Zach doesn't speak to you from beyond the grave. That's the power of this book. One of the things that Brenda Easter, Zach's mom, is so excited about, they started a foundation in Zach's honor, and they're trying to, they're funding they refer to it as a saliva study, which is basically like you get a big hit, you on the sidelines, you spit in a cup, and that can be tested. The proteins and enzymes in the spit can be tested to say positively, yes or no. Yes, you got a concussion. No, you didn't get a concussion.
Reid Forgrave, thank you so much for joining us.
This is awesome to be here. I really, really appreciate you spreading the word about Zach's story.
Proceeds from Love Zach go to the CTE Hope Foundation. Head to ctehope.com. Text Forgrave to 31996 to watch the full interview and find out what actor Will Smith has to do with this story. You can also download our Talking with Authors podcast.
They are the best-selling authors and all of your favorite genres. For in-depth, one-on-one interviews, go to hecmedia.org.
These are very interesting and very timely pieces. It's an opportunity to see something new and something different at the gallery. It is an opportunity to see a new collection of sculptures by newcomer Arnie Nadler and a series of prints that complement that as well. The established artists at the gallery have new and very exciting work, including landscape painting by St. Louis-based artist Douglas Freed, as well as video by Van McElway.
So the title of the exhibit is Firstlings, Sculptures and Works on Paper, and it's part of an ongoing series I've been doing for a couple of years. ceramic sculptures that respond to the figure and that are in various stages of kind of strange metamorphosis. And I also have a series of drawings that I call studies that I make in concert with the sculptures, and they both inspire sculptures, and then sculptures inspire them, and so there's this interesting kind of reciprocal relationship between them. I don't really start any of them like knowing exactly what I want them to look like. I tend to think about them more as how I want the sculptures to behave. I'll start actually making these parts out of clay and put them aside so they kind of stiffen up a bit, and then I'll start to graft them together to create compositions in space that kind of nod towards some type of anatomical structure, but not being aligned with any type of real anatomical correctness. They are about mass and space and volume and gesture. The issue of color is something I think about a lot and something that I actually wrestle with a lot. Some of these pieces actually used to have multiple colors on them. What I found is that by bringing them back to a monochromatic strategy, the pieces become much more about the form and less about the surface.
What I'm after is kind of distilling everything down to its just barest essential and leaving a kind of spiritual essence. Many of the paintings are kind of composites of numerous photographs. I don't take a photograph and copy the photograph, and neither are these specific places. The photo is like it freezes in my brain what I'm seeing, and then I get back to the studio and I can kind of digest that and process that and edit it into what I want it to be. And these are oil paintings. They're all slightly blurry. The very last thing I do after I bring the painting to a certain point, I take great big wallpaper brushes that are about so wide, and I just do a grid over the top of them. And I destroy that image that I've worked about 4 to 5 hours painting. And then I take about another hour to kind of bring it back. And then over a few days, I'll just barely tweak that from time to time. I think it's a distillation of abstraction and realism. I want there to be a certain kind of ambiguity in the paintings.
I had the idea in 2003 after the invasion of Iraq, and I was thinking not so much about a specific symbol, but more of a dream image, one that can resonate on a variety of levels in a number of ways. I was thinking of the flag and its shadow in sort of a Jungian sense, and wondering if a country could also have a shadow side in the sense that one, the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing, or there's an equal and opposite reaction to every effort, or sometimes we create the very forces that we're trying to run counter to. So all of these things were kind of running through my mind, and it's an obvious image of a split, of a schism. I actually started as a painting major, and then I went on to printmaking and started working in sound, and then began working in video as a way of combining all of those different elements. So I've always been fascinated with the potential of media. I always start with an idea, whether it's a sound idea or a video idea or just an image or a feeling. And with this particular piece, Flag and Its Shadow, it was one of those that just kind of dawned on me in a sense. I wanted to express it visually.
On display through December 23rd. For more info, visit BrunoDavidGallery.com. Music to put you in the holiday spirit later on Spotlight.
Telephone Museum is basically a history of the telephone dating back from the late 1870s to present. We did it basically to preserve the history of the telephone.
We have several hands-on exhibits, and we will show you the evolution to the smartphone.
This Telephone Museum project was worked on by the Telephone Pioneers of America. It's a group that goes back to 1911. We took on this project back in 2003, and we worked on it for 13 years and opened the museum on May 4th, 2016.
Here at the Jefferson Brooks Telephone Museum, we'll show you the journey of the telephone. We have an 1876 replica of the liquid telephone. We also have a 1900 Chicago tandem. This would have been the earliest wall phone that we have in the museum that a customer would have had in their home. It's called the Chicago Tandem. The reason they call it a tandem is because it actually housed two batteries, two liquid batteries here, one in here, one in here. The way this operates is you basically crank on the magneto. When you crank on the magneto, it sends an electrical signal down the telephone line, and then the operator would then pick up the call. The operator could be in a central office or she could be in her home, depending on the size of the company.
The phone booths were used back in the day because phones were very expensive for people to have in their homes. The phone booths were actually located all over the place. They were in hotels, they were in drug stores, they were in banks. The particular phone booth we have in our museum was actually a standalone because it has both the side panels, so ours was probably in a bank or a drug store. Our particular phone booth is actually from 1948, 1949. And it's got a hammered metal finish on the inside. Very, very, very popular. It's got the light that goes on when you go inside the payphone booth and actually close the door. It's also got a fan inside for summer days. It gets pretty warm in there, but we're pretty happy to have it. We have a 1909 pay station that actually has a lead chute inside. That lead chute was actually used to drop coins in. Back in the day, from 1909 up until probably the 60s and 70s, they had an operator listening in, and when you called to make a long distance phone call, the operator would tell you how much money to deposit in the pay station or eventually into the pay phone. She would listen. So there's actually three different coins. The quarter would actually be dropped in. It would actually sound like an old clock, like a dong. The dime would then go down a different chute and hit off the top and bottom of a bell and would go ding, ding. The nickel would then go down a different chute and hit off the bottom of the bell and just make a single ding. So that operator clearly heard that you just dropped 40 cents into the pay station or pay phone. Once you put all the money in that she requested, she would then connect the call for you. They used that in 1909 with the gray pay station. They were still using it with the three-slot pay telephones from the 60s and 70s. It worked just fine. They used the exact same mechanism 60, 70 years later. Princess Phone was the first telephone that Western Electric created with the name. They actually had 300 different name submissions, and they decided on the word Princess because every little girl wanted to have a telephone in her bedroom. So the Princess telephone came out in the early 60s. It was the most popular phone they ever sold. It had a motto: it's little, it's lovely, it lights, because you could actually light up the dial on the Princess phone like a nightlight in your bedroom at night. The goal of the Telephone Museum was basically to preserve history. I especially love seeing young people come in because a lot of young people have never seen some of these landline phones that we have. They're only familiar with, say, cell phones. So we just want to just basically keep the memory alive so the history of the telephone isn't lost with all this new technology.
To see the full story, visit hecmedia.org. You can find the stories featured in today's show along with past episodes and more at hecmedia.org/spotlight.
Oh. mortis nostre in ora nostre. Ave Maria.
To see the full concert, head to hecmedia.org and share it with your friends. Next week, a group giving families dealing with cancer one great day. Plus, a Pulitzer Prize winning author and his eclectic book that has a witty take on life in the Deep South. Thanks for watching Spotlight. Join us next Sunday at 9:30 a.m. on KPLR 11.